Good day, everyone. This is lecture one for chapter six on weathering in soils. Weathering occurs to rocks at or near the Earth's surface, and it involves physical as well as chemical changes in the rock. I'm going to differentiate between two types of weathering. The first is mechanical weathering, where a rock simply gets broken down into smaller pieces. There is no change in their chemistry. The second type of weathering is called chemical weathering. And in this process, there is a change in the composition of the rock. Generally, both of these processes, chemical and mechanical weathering, are occurring at the same time. This figure is showing a cube initially with six sides. With mechanical weathering, the six-sided cube gets broke into eight cubes and then further breaks down into additional cubes. Mechanical weathering then breaks the rocks into smaller and smaller pieces. That increases the surface area and increases the chance for chemical weathering. Looking at different types of mechanical weathering, I want to start with frost wedging. Frost wedging is where water gets into a crack and expands, and water expands 9%. When the water thaws, and more water gets into that larger crack, it refreezes, making the crack even larger until the rock begins to crumble, as shown in this picture here. If you've ever put a glass bottle into the freezer and forgot about it, the water will expand and break the glass. It's still glass, it's still water, the chemistry hasn't changed. All we have done is broke it into pieces. That is mechanical weathering, specifically frost wedging. If you happen to live near a coastal region where salt water is around, sea spray or salty groundwater can get into the cracks of rocks, and when the water evaporates, salt crystals will grow. This process continues, which will break down the rock into smaller pieces. Another mechanical weathering process is called sheeting or unloading. Unloading occurs when a large batholith, for example, is exposed at the Earth's surface through time. No longer is there a great overburden of material, and so the pressure, the confining pressure, is reduced. As a result, the rock essentially exhales and expands. Exfoliation domes can form as a result of sheeting and unloading. As an example of unloading, here we have a deep pluton. The overburden provides confining pressure. Once this pluton is exposed at the Earth's surface, it expands, and eventually, as demonstrated here at Half Dome in Yosemite National Park, exfoliation domes form. That is a process where the sheeting, the layers, begin to spall off the pluton. Biological activity is also a type of mechanical weathering. For example, plant roots that grow down into fractures of rock will grow and cause the rock to break into smaller pieces. Additionally, burrowing animals can help break rocks down, and humans as well can produce effects similar to unloading when they blast rock. Here, the root of this tree is extending into the joint of the rock, and as the tree and root grows, the rock will expand and eventually break off. The second type of weathering is called chemical weathering. And the major process involved with chemical weathering is the presence of water. Water will transport ions and molecules that help in the chemical weathering process. We will look at three specific chemical weathering processes: dissolution, when a rock dissolves; oxidation, like the rust on your red wagon; and hydrolysis. Let's start with dissolution. Let me give a couple of examples of where dissolution will occur. Certain minerals are simply susceptible to dissolving in water, such as salt, halite. In addition, small amounts of rainwater, which is slightly acidic by nature, can cause dissolution of carbonate rocks like limestones. That's where we get our caves and our caverns. It's due to dissolution of carbonate rocks. Carbonate rocks have calcite, are calcite rich, and as a result, a weak acid will dissolve them. This figure shows the dissolution of halite. Halite is sodium and chlorine ions, and when water is introduced to halite, water is a polar molecule. This means that one end of the molecule is more positive and the other end negative. What happens is the positive end of the molecule attacks the negative chlorine ion, and the negative end of the water molecule attacks the positive sodium ion. This attacking pulls apart the atom, and that is what dissolution is. Caves are formed by the dissolution of limestone by rainwater, which is naturally slightly acidic. Oxidation is another chemical weathering process. Oxidation occurs more rapidly in wet, warm climates than dry climates. Water will increase, as noted, the reaction, the speed of the reaction. Oxidation is important in decomposing ferromagnesium minerals. Those are the minerals that are rich in iron. Examples of ferromagnesium minerals include olivine, pyroxene, hornblende, and biotite. One note, oxidation can only occur after the iron has been freed from the silicate mineral by the process of hydrolysis, which I will discuss on the next slide. Well, maybe in the next slide. Here, let's look at a figure of, these are sedimentary rock layers. Note the red color that indicates oxidation of the rock. Another example would be rusted 55-gallon drums. So iron becomes oxidized in these two examples. Hydrolysis is the reaction of any substance with water. Think of the prefix hydro, means water. What happens with hydrolysis is the hydrogen ion attacks and replaces another ion. This is the primary way silicate minerals decompose. Clay minerals are the most abundant product of weathering. In particular, feldspars weather to clay minerals. The reason that feldspars weather to clay minerals is that feldspars are unstable at the Earth's surface and convert into clay, which is stable at the Earth's surface. Acid will greatly accelerate hydrolysis as well. Let me mention spheroidal weathering here. This is where weathering attacks edges from two sides and corners from three sides. What happens in this process is that sharp edges gradually wear down, become rounded. As an example, granite. Granite can have joints, which are just fractures in the rock, where water can get into. Water, the hydrogen part of the water will replace the potassium in the feldspars, which disrupts the crystalline structure, turning it into clay. Here we have water penetrating the granite that has joints in it. Chemical weathering decomposes the minerals and enlarges the joints. Rocks become attacked on the corners and edges and take on a spherical shape. A good example of spheroidal weathering occurs in Joshua Tree National Park in California. So here we start out with a cube and eventually it ends up rounded due to spheroidal weathering. This ends lecture 1 for chapter 6.